the Secret Life of Salmon. In this series, we'll take you on a wondrous journey of discovery to learn about one of the most remarkable creatures on planet Earth. My name is Margery, and I study Earth Science at the University of Oregon. I grew up on the Oregon coast, right here, near the mouth of the Salmon River, where it meets the sea.
We are inside the Cascade Head Biosphere Reserve, one of only 28 such biosphere regions in the U.S. This is a truly amazing place. It's one of the most beautiful, naturally preserved locations on Earth. Where better to tell you about the secret life of salmon?
I've always been fascinated by the variety of life that thrives in this place, especially the true superhero of fish species, the salmon. Salmon are amazing creatures, unlike any others on planet Earth. And this program will tell you what we know, but we'll also explore the questions that remain unanswered about the lives of salmon. Now, since the salmon's life cycle is an endless circle, there is no beginning or end. So we'll start our story where the salmon are born, further up the river to the east.
Salmon are born upstream in freshwater, grow up in rivers and estuaries, become adults in oceans, and then, amazingly, return back to the same streams where they were born to spawn and die. Spawn means to lay eggs in large numbers. These fish are special because they live both in freshwater and saltwater environments, something very few animals can do.
Scientists call species that can do this anadromous. Anadromous is the term that describes aquatic species born in freshwater that spend most of their lives in saltwater, then return to freshwater to spawn. Anadromous animal species undergo a special adaptation that allows them to thrive in these two distinctly different environments. An adaptation is a characteristic that helps a species survive and reproduce. Now, if you think about it, that would be similar to us being born on Earth, traveling to Mars for most of our lives, being able to breathe without spacesuits, then returning to Earth to have babies just before we die. Pretty amazing, don't you think?
This remarkable species of fish requires specific conditions to thrive, especially clear, cool, fast-running water. As it turns out, the environment also depends on salmon because they help to keep rivers and forests healthy. We'll learn more about these complex relationships later in our series.
Wild salmon are born and grow up in nature without the aid of humans, while hatchery-raised salmon are born in a facility built by humans and released into the wild when they are old enough to live on their own. We'll learn more about the life cycle of the salmon and how wild and hatchery salmon differ from one another. But in a nutshell, there are six main stages to the life of the salmon.
In the wild, the mother salmon lays her eggs and the father fertilizes them. Tiny baby salmon hatch from these eggs, becoming what are called alvin. Next, they develop into what are called fry, then smolts, then adults, and finally, spawners. In the hatchery, eggs are taken from the female and fertilized in buckets. The fertilized eggs are transferred to trays in an incubation room and left to hatch into alvin, which then develop into fry, then smolts, adults, and spawners. The Salmon River is home to three types of salmon, Chinook or King, Coho, and Chum. The easiest way to identify these three salmon? Chinook have black mouths with black gum lines and large black spots running down their backs. Coho have black mouths with a white gum line and are bright silver in color with no spots. And the Chum salmon's mouth is all white.
People and salmon have been closely connected for more than 9,000 years. However, the ways humans relate to the salmon are as different as night and day.
Native people of the Pacific Northwest have long considered salmon to be an extremely important gift of food from their creator. Each year, they honor the salmon's return in special ceremonies. Native Americans believe the salmon must be treated with respect. Through traditional fishing practices, they learned to limit the number of fish they took to be sure the salmon would return the next year. American settlers first began to reach the Pacific Northwest in the 1840s. The settlers that began to fish and trade salmon saw them as an endless resource and didn't realize the negative long-term effects of human activity like logging, farming, the damming of rivers, and overfishing. Within just 100 years, these practices led to huge declines in the number of salmon in Pacific Northwest rivers, from millions of fish down to just 6% of original populations.
Throughout this series, you will learn what we know about salmon, what we have yet to learn about their lives, the various ways people are working to protect them, and what you can do to help them too. The salmon are here, right now, in this river, on their way back to the very place they were born, in the small streams and tributaries just up ahead to the east. So let's begin our journey. Follow them there to discover more about the secret life of salmon. Come with me. Thank you.